all stand to our feet. Welcome back. You guys excited for church today? I don't think I've ever been more excited for church, yeah? All right, God, we open our hearts to you right now. We lift our voices to you right now. Have your way in this place. Father, I declare that this is the beginning of a brand new season. In Jesus' name. Silent, surely it was through. But since when has impossible ever stopped you? Friday's disappointment is Sunday's empty tomb. But since when has impossible ever stopped you? This is the sound of dry bones rattling. This is the praise make a dead man walk again. And open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. This is the sound of dry bones rattling. Yeah.
Make a dead man.
Father God, we just are so glad to be here. We're so glad that you're breathing life in this place. Lord, I just declare your blessing on this church, your blessing on these families, Lord, your blessing to just go before us in our coming, in our going. In Jesus' name. Yes, Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you.
Be
people said, amen, amen. You guys can have a seat.
Welcome to the Grace Place Phygital Worship Experience. You say, phygital? Is that a word? Well, it is today. It's a combination of the word physical and digital. So while we are now meeting together and gathering physically, and hundreds will participate, we believe that there'll be thousands who are participating today digitally. And so we welcome all of you and pray that you will open up your hearts to the Holy Spirit and to whatever He wants to do in you today.
If you're joining us for the first time, whether here in the building or online, we'd like to ask you to text the word welcome to 970-800-2421. That's a way where myself and some of the other pastors can connect with you. We can answer any questions you might have and get to know each other a little better.
If you're interested in learning more about Grace Place and how you can get connected into the Grace Place family, before or after service, you can meet with one of our connection specialists at the Get Connected table. They'll be able to give you information about how to get involved. And if you are part of our online campus, you can get involved too. Just pull out your phone and text the word online to 84321.
Thanks again for joining us today. And if you would like more information about Grace Place, please visit our website, graceplace.org.
Hey, Grace Place, today we are celebrating 24 years of Grace Place being open.
Yeah, it's awesome. It is awesome. Today is a great celebration for us as we think back and reflect back over 24 years of ministry and impact that Grace Place has had. It's been one heck of a journey.
Yeah, and I remember the first time I walked through the doors and I was 18, I was young, I was lost and looking for a place of acceptance, looking for a place of hope. And I found it here. And it's not because the people are perfect, the people have it all together, but the people exuded grace and forgiveness and love, just like Jesus would have done.
Yeah, and I was thinking, so just this past Friday was my 15-year anniversary of saying yes to Jesus, and that happened here at Grace Place. And just thinking about my journey of coming in angry, lost, young man to now becoming and being where my walking in my calling of being a pastor, and all of that happening through the ministry of Grace Place, and so many more things that we've seen happen over the years, the hundreds of thousands of baptisms.
Right.
The ministry in the community.
Lost being found, sick being healed, so much connection with our local community, our global community, and it's all because, not because of one person, not just because of Pastor Clay, even though he is amazing, but because of each of us being the church.
Yeah, so each of us partnering together in little ways and big ways. So many of you have partnered in ways that you might think that are small, but I always like to think of the widow's mite, right? It's that one little piece that makes a difference, and it's a difference, an impact on you don't know who. And so like, those of you who have partnered with Grace Place and give through Grace Place, you impact people's lives like mine,
right,
that has radically transformed it, and like yours.
Yeah, and it's all because of your faithfulness, your generosity, and so thank you so much for those of you who give regularly to support the ministry that happens through Grace Place. And if you have not jumped on board with giving through Grace Place to support all the ministry that happens, there are several ways that you can do that.
Yes, you can give online at graceplace.org. You can pull out your cell phone and text any amount to 84321. You can click the link if you're watching online that's like, I think over here.
Up there.
Down here, somewhere. You can click the link there, or you can always drop your offering in the giving boxes, because this week we're back to gathering together in person, or mail a check in to our address, which is on the screen online.
Yeah, so let's continue in worship and continue to celebrate Grace Place's 24th anniversary.
Woohoo!
Happy birthday, Grace Place. 24 years and counting. Selena and I moved here to Colorado in the early summer, late spring of 1996. And we spent the whole summer meeting in homes, in parks, in we went up in the mountains, we went all over the Front Range from Fort Collins to Longmont and all in between, just gathering folks, sharing vision. God had put it on my heart to move back to my home state and to plant a church from scratch. We had a little group, a little core group, and everybody started inviting friends, and they invited friends, and they invited friends, and momentum started to build during the summer. And on September 14, 1996, we launched Grace Place at the Berthoud High School auditorium. During the first 4 years, we had a lot of schedule conflicts, so we ended up bouncing around one place after another, even met outside a few times, and that's how it is when you're a startup church. We ended up in, I think, 7 different locations before we moved into our first permanent building, which was downtown 250 Mountain. It's now New Freedom Outreach, downtown Berthoud. And we began to establish a presence there and to grow. We had a 300-seat auditorium there. And so pretty soon we went to 2 services. Eventually we went to 3 services. We started expanding. We had a building down the street for children, another one down 2nd Street for a student center. We ended up another building for some more offices. And we said, well, we need a 4th service. And so we decided to try an experiment. We started a Loveland campus up at Thompson Valley High School. And so for 3 years, we had 3 services in Berthoud and 1 service in Loveland. I think it was about 2008 when the economy crashed. It kind of a perfect storm of events hit us. And we made a tough decision to close down that Loveland site and to regroup here. We'd had 2 office buildings and 2 student pastors and 2 kids leaders. And it just didn't make sense economically as we were facing some tough times at that time. And that was a very difficult decision, by the way. That was the first time I went to professional counseling because I got so discouraged with my leadership and wondering what we should have done better and how we should have done that different. If we had not closed the Loveland campus, we probably wouldn't be where we're gathered now. And so God had a plan all along, and there were good things that came out of all of those different stretches as we went together. But we found this property, and that's a whole long story in itself. It wasn't even on the market, and it was a long negotiation to get this beautiful piece of land here on this major highway in northern Colorado with so much visibility and accessibility. God is so faithful. We had a campaign called Reimagine. And many of you, some of you weren't here yet, many of you sacrificed. And you gave so generously to make this happen. And the prices went up during construction, and we had to do a kind of a campaign within a campaign, and our faith was stretched. We were tested during that time. But we saw over and over again that God is faithful. 5 years ago this month, the end of this month, we moved in onto our new campus, and a couple years ago, we started live streaming our services, not knowing how much it was going to be valuable when we got to the year 2020. But I just want to say today, God is faithful. How many agree with that? Amen. Let me hear you. Amen. Check out this verse. 1 Corinthians 1:9 says, God is faithful. Say it with me. God is faithful, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Well, so many ups and downs and victories and different seasons we've been in as a church over the years. And we come to 2020. And the first quarter of this year, it was nothing but momentum in so many ways. So encouraging growth, coming off of 109 baptisms last year. And we go into this fun Enneagram series, understanding ourselves and each other. We were small groups. We're just loving that study, and we're going through that first quarter with momentum and in groups and in serving, and we've got a new cafe manager with new ideas. We're looking towards launching Grace Place College, which had been a long time vision, train up young adults to get into ministry and leadership, and then we got disrupted. That's the name of this message. We got 2020'd. You know what I'm talking about? This is some kind of a year, huh? With everything going on, and then we get all these fires, and did you read about there's an asteroid headed our way the day before the election? It was 2020.
So it's been 6 months since we gathered in our building. 6 months, hard to believe. And during that time, our staff pivoted, another key word for 2020, and we worked as hard as we could to be connected as a team to each other, but more importantly, to you, stay connected to you, produce content to serve you, to serve the community. I'm really proud of our staff team who's worked so hard and learned. We've learned a lot during this difficult time. It hasn't been easy. It was a very difficult thing to close our church campus. But we've been reminded during this stretch that the church is not a building, right? We love these facilities because they facilitate, but they aren't the church. The buildings on our campus aren't the church. It's you. It's you. It's people. And so, you know, Jesus said, I'm going to build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Amen? So some little virus is not going to shut us down. But boy, did it ever change our country and our world temporarily and permanently in certain ways, as I'm sure we'll see as time goes on. Then all of a sudden, our country just erupts with chaos. And we've all been through this difficult time, and we're still in it. Racial tensions and distrust. And then, you know, protests that go wild and rioting and looting and violence. And there's so much fear. And then all these restrictions, and they're different in different counties and different states. And trying to figure it out. And there's mask mandates and hand washing. And then everything is political. And there's so much political division and anger. I'm tired of it. I'm worn. Are you? It's so intense. There's so much anger, and everything is political. Masks are political. What? And the NFL is political. I can't believe it. I put a post up about it. I'm so glad to watch football again. I got blasted like 50 people. Come on, you guys, lighten up. Hey, we're going into an election. Did you know that? You know, it's just a few weeks away. And if you're not a Christ follower, you can just not listen to me right now. I'm so glad you're listening, but you don't have to, you know, take this unless it sounds good to you. But if you are a Christ follower, I would like to encourage you, if you're involved in social media, and I'm encouraging myself too, okay, because I put up a political post apparently this week. But if you're a Christ follower, I'd like to encourage you, if you go on digital platforms between now and the election, this list I think is good. Check this out. See what you think about this. Post wisely over the next months. Maybe even pray sometimes if you're a little worried about the impact. Contribute to discourse, not division. Check your facts. Don't let somebody else facts check after you post. Resist memes and cheap digs. Create beautiful content. And I really believe that we can, if we really work together, we can transcend the bitterness and be better even when we disagree. What do you think? If you're a follower of Jesus, and you're patriotic, that's wonderful. But are you an American first, or are you a Christ follower first? I really want to ask myself that question and let that impact my behavior all the time, but especially during this season that we're going into. And think about this. I want to talk to you about this later in the future because I've been thinking a lot about this and doing research on it. But we have an opportunity that generations before us never had. You see, if you're a follower of Jesus, you are called to be a missionary. Whether you go overseas, whether you ever preach a sermon, you are a sermon. Because if people know you follow Jesus, they're going to say, okay, what does that mean? And I'm going to watch you and see what that means. So when we go on digital platforms, let's think of ourselves, if we're followers of Jesus, as digital missionaries. The Apostle Paul traveled all over, and he had hardship. He had, you know, his shipwrecks and all kinds of problems. He got beaten, stoned, and all kinds of stuff. If he would have had the opportunity to have digital platforms to keep talking about Jesus in winsome and attractive ways, and to try to encourage and bring hope, I think he would have been thrilled. So let's see ourselves as digital missionaries. Okay, that's just a little side there. Now, during this disruption, for me, there's been some good things, and maybe for you. Maybe you can make a list and talk about it with your spouse or your family or somebody or friend. I've had more time with my wife than normal, especially when we were homebound. And to me, that's a wonderful thing. We've had some good talks together, some good walks together, some good time together. We started out Watching the news like never before, trying to figure out what's going on. We were watching it in the morning as soon as we got up, we'd get our coffee, we'd watch it at night. And we got so depressed watching the news. We finally, after, anybody know what I'm talking about? I mean, we waited too long, I think, didn't we? It was like 2 months. And we finally said, let's just turn that off. Haven't watched it, I don't think, since. You know, scan the headlines online. But wow, we did. And when we did that, we started reading a lot more. And we read some great books. In fact, Celine read several books out loud to me, which was a blessing for both of us. We did a big landscape project. It took a lot of focus and energy and turned out really nice. Did some little short mountain getaways. And of course, I got a few opportunities to social distance on my motorcycle, which was always a good and renewing thing for me. But, and make a list. You know, think about what's been good. What have you learned and what have you, can you appreciate from this time? But there's, for all of us, there's been a loss. And to recognize that and name it can be helpful. There's the loss of gathering together. And, you know, I'm speaking to this camera because I know a lot of you aren't here yet, and I can't wait to see you, but just the people that have showed up today, it just warms my heart to see you because I missed you so much. And to sing with you, Selena and I were just crying during that first song. She got it started. And she said, oh, I forgot how much I missed. I knew I missed this place, but I didn't realize how intensely I missed being together with people and singing and fellowship and serving together. And then so much got canceled. We had trips. We had a bunch of trips that got canceled with some of you. We had 70 people going to Israel, got postponed. And then a lot of people started dropping off. And you know, I don't know how many people will be going next year. But those kind of things are just lost and disappointing. You know, our Grace Place College, it's going to happen, we believe, in the future. But it's been delayed. We closed our cafe. You know how painful that was after, like, for me to make that decision? After, like, 18 years, that cafe's never closed. And yet, you know, we got hit with this. And you got to wrestle with it. Thank you so much, by the way, those of you who tried to help out during that time where we were still open, trying to do carry out and doing home box meals, and many of you bought those, and some of you paid it ahead. Thousands of dollars worth of those were distributed to people who really needed them. So thank you for that. But when we were trying to, you know, reopen with restrictions, we'd already lost a fair amount of money. And then our cafe manager decided to resign. And it was just was at a time where it was just the final hit. And we sadly said, okay, we're going to close it for a season. We're going to reopen it when the time is right. Somebody sent me a message a couple weeks ago. Hi, Pastor Clay. I had a question. Why isn't the Trailhead Cafe open when every single other cafe or restaurant is? Well, first of all, I would say not every other one is open. A lot of them have closed, and many of them have closed permanently. Most of them in Berthoud are open, but many of them are really struggling. You know, support whoever you want to support because they need it. In fact, we've loaned some of our outdoor tables temporarily to some of the restaurants in town so that they can have some outdoor seating, trying to be helpful in that regard. And we plan to bring back our cafe ministry, and we plan to bring it back strong when the time is right, when the leader and the vision come together. But these are just examples of loss. What about you? You've got your list. You've experienced loss. It might be income, it might be health in some way, maybe your trips got canceled. My heart goes out to you high school seniors and college seniors, but especially high school seniors and all the things that you wanted to do that you weren't able to do, and you just had to adjust, but it was a loss, no doubt. Sports, I mean, kids, young athletes, kids that want scholarships, parents that, you know, want to support their kids in that, lots of disappointment. Proverbs 13:12 says, hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life. There has been during this season a lot more hope deferred than longing fulfilled. And that can lead to your heart feeling sick. Anybody feel some of that? Anybody with me on this? Or are you guys just all cruising? Yeah, emotionally, front row, yep. And you guys, you could say it in the comments if you're identifying in any way. And listen, if you do feel heart sick, it is important to admit that, to talk about that, to find ways to get healthier. And here's why. Proverbs 4:23. The first time I went to professional counseling, the first day, the counselor showed me this verse, and I'd read it many times, but the way he applied it really convicted me. And that is, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. And the way he applied it was to emotions. And you know, those are heart issues, and if your heart isn't healthy, then it's going to affect other things. It's going to affect you in other ways, and it's going to affect other people. Everything flows from it. In addition to all the loss, there's been pressure. There's been this pressure. If you're a leader, if you're a father, if you're a mother, if you're a student, whatever it is, there's this pressure. And on me, first of all, I've had the pressure, especially early on, until I found out how faithful this congregation is, and I cannot thank you enough. But I had the pressure of, will we be able to make our mortgage payment with that empty building there sitting there? Will we be able to pay all of our staff and keep our staff team together? You know, how, what kind of a hit are we going to take? And not everybody feels that, but I feel that as the leader, and I feel it intensely. And then, and again, I cannot thank you enough for your generosity. I mean, we are right about where we were last year in spite of all this. We've intended to be 10% ahead based on growth last year, and so we've had to adjust our budget some, but we haven't had to lay off our staff except for, unfortunately, our cafe staff at this time. And it's because of your generosity and your faithfulness, even during tough times, and I just thank you for being that kind of a church, because it's not the case in a lot of churches. I feel pressure from stats that I read about the church. George Barna, one of the most respected research firms, has done studies and said that 1 in 5 churches are potentially and likely going to close in the next 18 months. I'm not worried about Grace Place closing. I know that's not going to happen, but this stat really bothers me. George Barna says that since the shutdowns, 1/3 of everyone who was participating in churches, 1/3 checked out, didn't follow digitally, just checked out. I hope if some of you were in that category and came back, great. I hope others will come back. And that worries me. Have we lost people? Where are they? How are they doing? And then the pressure of decision making, you know, the timing for reopening. And listen, there's a lot of people with an opinion about it, I found out. So, I mean, you're damned if you do and damned if you don't, sort of, really. I mean, because there's people that say you should never close, or you should have opened a lot sooner. And there's people that say not until you get a vaccine, and there's all in between. And I feel conflicted, because on the one hand, I feel like, you can't tell me what to do. You can't take away my rights. We're going to open when we want to. And on the other hand, let's be responsible. Let's be careful. Let's be good leaders. And so there's that tension and conflict internally. And it's led me to feel edgy and down and sad at different times. And I think you guys can relate. What about you? I mean, what have been your pressures that have been intensified? Challenges with parenting, with finances, with marriages. A lot of marriages have really suffered during this time, unfortunately. What about education? You know, school. We think about how hard it is for parents who are trying to work and still, you know, keep their kids going with their online classes, but it's hard for these kids. I mean, I keep hearing stories about especially little kids that just can't sit there for 7 hours in front of a screen, and they're crying and they're depressed. And we got to get them back in the schools, I hope, soon. But that's just my opinion. And I know that every time I give my opinion, I'm in danger zone. But, I mean, think about teachers, too, okay? Don't leave the teachers out. I'm married to one. And it was very stressful for her to try to figure out she's a great teacher, but how to go digital. And that's a whole new learning curve. And it's difficult for everybody. There's pressure to make ends meet, pressure to, you know, whether I work from home or I go to work, and I got to work all day with a mask, and many have declined in their physical and emotional health, and it's led to addictions, it's led to depression, and to some sad stories. One day after a meeting here at the church with some of my staff, I sat down in my chair in my office, and I just felt pissed off, and I could not tell why. I mean, I was like, there'd been a little give and take and pushback and, you know, interaction and not conflict, but just good interaction that needs to happen in a team. Normal. Nothing was different. But for some reason, I just felt angry. And I'm like, what am I angry at? And who am I angry at? I couldn't figure it out. And finally, I just sat there and I thought, you know what? I have been suppressing emotions, trying to ignore them, trying to act like they don't bother me. I can just get past it. It was hard to label what they were, but it was a combination of grief, sadness, concern, pressure that I've already talked about over decisions, figuring out the news. You know what? How do you find accurate news in this world today? That is so frustrating. And so And, you know, having a shorter fuse, I could see that I have a shorter fuse. And by the way, I read just this week, according to the National Institute for Mental Health, men with depression often hide their emotions, may seem angry, irritable, or negatively aggressive, while many women seem sad or express sadness. Now, that's, you know, it's not always the case. But in general, you know, women are quicker to express it than men. And I can relate to that. And so sitting right there at that moment, realizing that, I decided, you know what, it's been 12 years, but I am going back to a Christian counselor because I need to get my heart healthy. And so I've been doing that now for a number of weeks, starting about 6 weeks ago. And it's been very helpful, but it made me wonder, how are you doing? How are you guys doing emotionally? Is it easy to answer or is it hard to answer? Have you named it? In fact, if you would think, what is my emotional state now, or what has it been, and you put it into one word, what's the first word that comes to mind for how you've been emotionally? If you can think of a word, turn and say it to somebody. If you feel brave or you feel like vulnerable and you want to share, you put it in the comments. You know, and just turn to somebody and what is the one word? In fact, give me a couple if you want. No cussing. Anybody brave enough to give me a one-word emotion? Depressed, frustrated, irritated, sad, disappointed, tired, nameless, aimless. Wow, angry. Not a whole lot of positive stuff going on here. I get a feeling that people are relating with me here today, that we're kind of all in the same thing together. Now, I want you to hear this. God does not tell us anywhere in the Bible to deny our emotions. In fact, read the Psalms. He validates them. Okay? So, don't think that it's a bad thing to have any of these emotions. It's a normal thing. It's the way God created you. It's a good thing to name it, like you're doing now, and to talk to other people about it. Because when we deny it, I'm speaking to the voice of experience, and we suppress those emotions, then, you know, it can come out in ways that aren't positive and drag us down. So we've got to learn emotional management skills. There's an interesting verse in Ephesians. We just got done studying Ephesians this year. It says, be angry, comma, but sin not. Be angry and sin not, it says. So you can substitute other emotions for anger. Think of any emotion that you're feeling that you've named, and God says, be that. Yeah, that's normal. Be that, but manage that. Don't let that go south. Don't let that turn into something negative and sinful. Learn how to manage that emotion, but don't deny it. I was talking to a Christian counselor last month, and I said, man, I'm usually really up, and I just wake up the next morning. If I'm down about something, I'm better in the morning. And I'm pretty optimistic, but I've just felt down, and I don't know if I'm depressed or discouraged or what the word is. And he said something interesting I've never heard before. He said, some people at their core get depressed, and it results in anxiety. Some people in their core get anxious, and it results in depression. I said, really? I don't know that either one of those apply to me. He goes, yeah, they do. He said, I've been listening to you. I think you've got anxiety at your core. And I said, I'm not a worrier. He said, what? You just talked about your staff and your building and your decisions and your leadership and whether you're a good leader or a bad leader and all this stuff. He said, that's anxiety at your core. And that's what you need to deal with. And then he told me this, and I found this fascinating. He said, when you worry, you become weary and eventually worn. Worry, weary, worn. Can anybody relate to that? To that word worn? I can relate to that. Now, don't think it's a sign of weakness or a lack of faith just because you feel discouraged. Hear me. Jesus understands what it feels like. In his humanity, he felt a full range of emotions without sinning. He was worried. He was lonely. He was afraid. He was overwhelmed. Just read the night before the cross in the garden when he cried out to his father, can this cup pass? Is there another way to do this? Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. He resigned to his father's will, but he was emotional. He was angry at times, often compassionate, joyful, as well as sad. It's okay to be troubled by the news. It's okay to be troubled by the state of this union. It's okay to be uncertain about this global pandemic and all of its implications. And it's okay. In fact, it's healthy to name and acknowledge those emotions. You know, shortest verse in the Bible, you know what it is? Say it with me. Jesus wept. Two words. But it tells us a lot about his humanity, doesn't it? Jesus wept. He felt emotion. But he processed it in healthy ways. If you study his life, you'll see that. He didn't allow it to paralyze him. He kept moving in the direction of God's will, whether he felt like it or not. And he would regularly retreat for replenishment. In fact, I've always loved that story where in the middle of a storm, where is he? He's been working hard all day, and he knows he needs refreshment, so he's sleeping in the back of the boat. He's trusting his father. Anyone besides me feel weary or worn? Yep, I know. I knew it would be true. Check this out. This is the words of Jesus from Eugene Peterson's paraphrase called The Message. Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Are you tired? Worn out? How appropriate. Burned out on religion? Come to me, Jesus said. Get away with me and you'll, notice this, recover your life. Anybody need that? I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch what I do. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I love that phrase. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. During this season, I came across a song I'd never heard before by 10th Avenue North, and it's called Worn. And I asked the band if they would bring this song as a message, and then we're going to unpack it just briefly afterwards and apply it to our lives. And a few of the phrases say, I'm tired, I'm worn, my heart is heavy from the work it takes to keep on breathing. I've made mistakes, I've let my hope fail, my soul feels crushed by the weight of this world. And this line really struck me. I'm worn even before the day begins. If you wake up and already feel worn, that's a signal. I'm worn. I've lost my will to fight. I'm worn. And then it talks about hope. And so I want you to just sit back wherever you are and listen to this song, listen to the lyrics, and ask the Lord what he's saying to you personally today.
Thank you.
just won't let up. And I know that you can give me rest. So I cry out with all that I have left. And let me see redemption win. Let me know the struggle ends. That you can mend a heart that's frail.
Relate to that song, to the emotions of feeling worn? Please hear Jesus saying these words to you personally. He says, are you tired? Worn out? Come to me. Get away with me, and you will recover your life. What do you need to do to recover your life? Take a break. Get away. Talk to someone, friend, pastor, counselor. Get a new project or hobby. Get healthier physically, exercise, eat better. Get outside, get some vitamin D. Establish a better routine. Read an encouraging book. Maybe you need to start or restart a spiritual practice. Because Jesus says, I'll promise you, I will help you recover your life if you spend time with me. Spend time with me, he says. One thing we're not doing, listen to me, we're not giving up. Not giving up. Anybody been tempted to give up on something? I know a lot of people have. Let's resolve to not do that. Don't give up on becoming a better parent and a better spouse, a better employee and a better employer, but most importantly, a more devoted follower of Jesus. You know, it's just like any relationship. If it starts to slip, it can get corrected with some intentionality. Let's move toward Jesus, not away from him during this time of challenge. Don't give up. I can guarantee you he won't give up on you. That second song we sang today, he's for you, he's for you. That's out of the Bible. That's not just some songwriter. Stress levels are crazy high right now, especially on leaders, on decision makers. You know what? There's no manual on doing church in a pandemic. At least not written in the last 100 years. The only scripture I could find that seems to directly address the situation was also from Eugene Peterson's paraphrase, The Message. It's 2 Corinthians 4:2. Let me read it to you. We refuse to wear masks and play games. Did you know that was in the Bible? That's in the Bible. Hey, we got to laugh during this season too, don't we? You got to find ways to laugh if you want to be healthy. because it cheers you up to have some good humor. Don't quote that out of context, by the way, like I just did. Even if it describes how you feel right now, that's not exactly what it's saying in context. But the reason I showed you that was not only because it's funny, but because later in the same chapter, in the same message translation, I love what Paul says. He says, so we're not giving up. And that's after he lists all this crazy stuff that he went through in his ministry. I mean, he went through a lot, and there was lots of opportunities where he could have just quit and hung up his shingle and gone back and done something easier. But he would not give up. Grace Place, I declare to you on our 24th anniversary, we are not giving up. Are you with me? We're not giving up on each other, no matter how exasperated we might get with each other at times. We're not giving up on our mission to break barriers, to build bridges, to bring hope. We're not giving up on gathering together as the Lord instructed us to do, as safely as we can. We're not giving up on our local and global missions and our external focus as a church. In fact, that focus has only increased during this season. We are not giving up. Like a boxer in a ring that gets knocked down and gets back up if he's not knocked out. We're not going to get knocked out. We might get knocked down, but we're going to get up. I get knocked down, but I get up again. There's a song. I went Pastor Hollis on you there for a minute. Great message last week, brother, and it really set up this, because we lose our focus when we target fixate on the wrong thing. We got to get our focus on the right thing, and that starts with fixing our eyes on Jesus. We're not giving up. Paul says, we're hard-pressed but not crushed. We're perplexed but not in despair. We're persecuted but not abandoned. We're struck down but not destroyed. We're not giving up. God is still faithful. Yeah, God's faithful, but he's still faithful, and he's going to always be faithful. You can take that to the bank. Hang in there, dear friends. Better times are ahead, and I encourage you to let this be your resolve. It's 2 Corinthians 4:16 to 18. It says, so we're not giving up. Would you read that with me? So we're not giving up. How could we? Even though on the outside, it often looks like things are falling apart on us. On the inside, where God is making new life, not a day goes by without his unfolding grace. These hard times are small potatoes compared to the coming good times. The lavish celebration prepared for us. There's far more here than meets the eye. The things we see now are here today, gone tomorrow, but the things we can't see now will last forever. Please be encouraged. And I invite you, if you're in the building with me, to stand for prayer and to join us on whatever platform you're with us today as we pray. And we say, Lord, we believe that you are faithful, the God of Abraham and Jacob and Isaac. And Lord, you have shown yourself faithful in so many ways throughout history and throughout our lives. Forgive us when we've doubted your faithfulness during hard times. Renew us. Renew our hearts spiritually, emotionally. Lord, revive us. Revive us as only you can do through your Spirit. The dead bones come to life. Lord, thank you. Thank you for your sustaining grace in our lives. We are so in need of your touch. And we thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen.